It's always a joy and a privilege to come into the presence of God. The Bible says that His right hand are pleasures forevermore. I'm aware of the presence of the Lord even right now, and I'm sure you too. Let's just bow for a moment and allow Him to speak to your hearts. I want to encourage you that I believe in the gifts of the Holy Ghost. If the Lord lays a word upon your heart to speak a prophecy, a tongue and an interpretation, do so as the Lord leads you. We need a word from God constantly. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, we honor you, Father. We bless you. Blessed be your holy name. Oh, sweet, sweet, gentle, double God. Hallelujah. Sweet, sweet Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's turn our attention this afternoon to the book of Genesis, chapter 22. I've got an echo in the mic. I'm going to continue in the vein of the just shall live by faith. Genesis chapter 22. Now it came to pass after that. These things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am. Then he said, take now your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son. And he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The lad and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and two of them went together. But Isaac spoke to Abraham his father and said, my father, and he said, here I am, my son. Then he said, look, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Then they came to the place of which God had told him, and Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. So he said, here I am. And he said, do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him, for I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Then Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went up and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said, "To this day in the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." Then the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing and have not withheld your only son, blessing I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven, as the sand which is on the seashore, and your descendants shall possess the gate of the enemies. In your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice." So Abraham returned to his young men, and they rose and went together to Beersheba. And Abraham dwelt at Beersheba. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Israel, please bless us. Pray in tongues if you want to say.
Alleluia, ti ho formato direttore tuo, dunque corporazione da mare. Non ti ricordo tua, ti ho formato la mare, padre Dio tua, infatti da mare chi deve tutto corporazione. E ti ho voluto ricorsi su, poi hai corporato, e vea magari parto da mare, e la mangia per affiona tua. Non io tua, e tolta, quando per cui hai in la torre, e la lava mai si su. Non ti ho tolto, ma ho fatto poco più una volta mai. La mangia per affiona, e quando si su, fa muovi, amen.
Thank you, brother Israel. It is important to notice the phrase that God uses concerning Isaac. He said it three times, "Your only son, thine only son." We know that God is aware of all that takes place in the secret place, and even in the not secret place. Surely God was totally aware that Abraham had had another son named Ishmael. But God purposely says to Abraham, "Thine only son," and he mentions it three times. And I've taught you previously that three is a very important number in the study of biblical numerology. And I always use the scripture found in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12, that a threefold cord cannot easily be broken. Was God saying this purposely? Was God emphasizing the fact that God termed and viewed Isaac as the only son of Abraham? God is aware of all what you do and I do in the secret place and the not secret place. Surely God was aware of Ishmael. But God says purposely, thine only son. For this reason, God recognized Isaac only as the promised one. God knew of Ishmael, but the promise was not with Ishmael. The promise was with Isaac. Because God had promised Abraham and God had promised Sarah that out of their own bodies would come the promised son. And we know that you and I are strange people. Very often we hear from God, and because God takes too long to bring his promises to pass to you and I, we often interfere with the promises of God, and we feel that we can contribute to God in bringing to pass the promises of God. Sarah and Abraham interfered with the promise of God. She said to Abraham that I'm at an age now, I cannot bear children anymore. And we cannot in any way leave our inheritance to a servant, because Abraham had said the self-same fact, that he has no one to leave all his wealth and even the promises of God unto. But God promised him. But Sarah, in a moment of doubt, in a moment of weakness, makes this foolish suggestion. And she says to Abraham, take my maid servant and lie with her. And who knows, God will give us seed from my maid servant Hagar. They interfered with the promises of God. All that you and I have to do concerning the promises of God is to believe it, take God as his word, never ever to interfere with it. I've known of men of God who God had spoken to and given a personal word, and they interfered with the promise of God, thinking that they could contribute to it, that they could help God in bringing to pass his word. God doesn't need you. God doesn't need me to bring his word to pass. He watches over his own word to bring it to pass. Where God is concerned, heaven and earth will pass away, but never his word. Yes. God has honored his word even above his name. God watches his word jealously. Yes. And let me say this. You and I, any person, you only as good as your word. And we are living in a time when no man's word can be trusted. But I remember as a young man, listening to my father speak to other men, enter into agreements. My father would always say, I give you my word. And whenever they made a promise, they said their word and they shook hands. And I tell you, my father would always say, I lay my head on the block. In other words, I give my life for my word. No more are we living in these days where people honor their word. But I can assure you there is one that honors his word, and that is God through the person of Jesus Christ. We need not interfere with the promises of God. God will bring to pass his word. Up to this very day, because Abraham and Sarah interfered with the promises of God, there's war between the Israelis and the Muslim world. All because of one foolish act of a man and a woman who doubted God. But God says this to Abraham, offer thine only son. It's not surprising when you read that scripture that the term son is mentioned 10 times. 3 times by God when he says, thine only son. God only recognizes his blessing in your life and in my life. God doesn't recognize my endeavors to bring about his purposes. And as I told you about this man and many men, God spoke to this man and wife and said to them, you would travel the world preaching my gospel. And they couldn't wait anymore. You know what they've done? They sold their own personal house to try and bring God's purposes to pass. When God calls, God provides. Amen. You don't need to contribute anything towards it, but just yourself. Give yourself unto God. God had promised me also that I would travel the world, and I traveled a bit preaching the word. And whenever I traveled, God used his money and not my money. In fact, I had no money to contribute. But what I'm saying is this, never ever interfere in the promises of God. We spoke last week about faith, how that we must exercise faith in the word of God, how that we must exercise in the blood of the Lamb and in the Holy Spirit. Now, in our modern day church, We are, sad to say, inundated with a doctrine that is contrary to Scripture, and that is the faith doctrine. I said to you, the just shall live by faith. And there's no other way to live, but not faith in faith. Faith in the Word of God. And what is taking place in this modern day church is that they have elevated a spoken word above what is known as the written word. A word for the now known as the rhema or the rhema, as opposed to the logos, the written word. And I believe in the spoken word. I believe that God speaks to you and to me today, just as He spoke to Abraham. Just as He spoke to Abraham, God speaks to you and to me. But what you must understand is this: the spoken word that God had spoken to Abraham has now become the written word. And there is a major distinction between the written word and the spoken word today. There are two groups of evangelicals that we need to remind ourselves of today. And that is the charismatic group and the Pentecostal group. I view myself as a Pentecostal man. You, in most cases, would view yourself as a Pentecostal as well. But the charismatic movement was a movement that came into fruition in the early and late 70s. Throughout the world, thousands and thousands upon thousands of Catholics and Anglicans were getting saved. And they came into the Pentecostal movement, but some of the other, the term was given to them as the charismatics. Now, it is this movement that believes very strongly in a spoken word. Spoken in a sense that God will speak to you personally, or God will speak to you through a prophet, through a dream, through a vision. Now, I agree. God does speak this way to you and I. Amen?
Amen?
But whatever God speaks to you and I in a dream or in a vision or through a prophecy or through another person of God is subject to the judgment of the Word of God.
Amen.
And there are many people in our modern day who are confirming the cause of God as prophets, as apostles, as pastors, as teachers, by referring to a prophecy. Prophet so-and-so called me. And whenever their callings are challenged or questioned, they lose their cool and find their temper and swear that because so-and-so called them by prophecy or by any gift as a word of knowledge, then that is not to be questioned. The charismatics believe that your life can be ordered and directed through the word spoken by a man of God or a woman of God. Now, we don't believe that. We don't believe that. We do not grieve the Spirit of God. We believe in prophecy. We believe in men of God speaking forth the word of God, but we believe what is said must be judged by the word of God.
Yes.
And I can give you an example. The apostolic ministry of Paul the Apostle was challenged by the Corinthian church, and he began to defend his calling. But you know, Paul had a very unique relationship with God. Jesus Christ appeared to him. And when he challenged the Corinthian church, he never referred in any way to his personal encounter with the Lord. He never said, "The Lord called me." He never said, "Ananias laid hands upon me and told me I'm called to be an apostle to the Gentiles." No! He never ever referred to any personal encounter or any personal word, spoken word, that he got from people of God. You know what he said? You people that deny my very apostolic ministry of the fruit of my ministry.
Amen.
You the fruit of my ministry. And there are too many people these days that are being governed by spoken words. We are governed by the word of God. Now listen to me. I'm going to give you a simple illustration. Then you can tell me what is more powerful, the spoken word or the written word. In the book of Corinthians, we read of the gifts and the function of the gifts. Chapter 11, 12, 13, and 14. We read of it, the distribution of it, and how it functions. And it says there, let the prophets prophesy, two or by three, and let the others judge. Now I ask you the question, as they would prophesy, as they would speak, by what means are they to judge? By what means are they to judge? The prophet has spoken. A spoken word, a word from the Holy Ghost. But it says, although the prophet or prophets have spoken, it must be judged. How do we judge it? That's it, sister, by the word of God. Now you tell me, what's more powerful? That which is used as the means to judge, the spoken word or the spoken word? The means. So if the written word judges the spoken word, then what must we depend upon? The spoken word or the written word? The written word. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And what I want to convey to you today is this. God does speak to us. But the Bible says that our steps are ordered by the Lord. And how does God order the steps of His people? The word is a lamp, a light to our feet and our path. God governs us and directs us by the written word and not by the spoken word. But the Bible says we mustn't grieve the work of the Holy Ghost. But we must be careful. For this reason, there are many, many voices in the air. I want to give you an example. I sense in my spirit that you love my ministry. But you know, I made a mistake a couple of weeks ago in my preaching. It wasn't a doctrinal mistake. It was a small error. Amen. And many of you missed it. I spoke about the pieces that form the passageway. Instead of saying eight at one time, I said 10. I made a mistake. So even when I preach, you've got to just not accept what I say. You've got to judge it. Check it out in the Word of God. Amen? And you're going to come to a time in your experience where a lot of people are going to speak to you and prophesy over you. And we're not going to reject it. But we're going to judge it in the light of God's word.
Amen.
Amen. Now, I was not supposed to say all that. It was supposed to wait for next week. But never mind. But I'm going to teach you next week how to judge what people say to you. How to judge the man of God that preaches. You can't be gullible. The Bible says there are many voices in the air. Many voices. And there's a thin line between truth and an extension of truth. Do you know that with every movement of God, God pours out upon that movement truth? But no sooner the truth is born, that man will extend that truth. And a classic example of it is when God poured out His Spirit in the early 20th century in Azusa Street. And we were reawakened to the gift of Pentecost speaking in tongues. It was of God. But after a time, they felt they could write in tongues as well. Totally wrong. And most moves of God start pure, but they soon go off the rails because man interferes with God's move. Amen? And even the faith movement, though I said the just must live by faith, we don't have faith in faith, we have faith in the Word of God. How do we know that we've heard from God? Okay, that I will teach you next week. But let's go on with what took place in the life of this great man, Abraham. For your information, you must understand that the Rhema is a spoken word. The Logos is the written word. And the written word is the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Amen. And the Word was with God. That's the Logos. And the Word was made flesh. That's Jesus. Amen. The Word is Jesus. The Word is a person. Amen. And the written word is a revelation of who? The written word is a revelation of who? Of Jesus. But in most cases, the spoken word that we have today is towards you and I. And therein lies the danger. But let's go on. Abraham heard a definite word from God. And God said to him to offer up his only son unto God. Like I said three times, thine only son. He heeds God's word. We ask ourselves the question, why does he obey God's word unreservedly? Why does he just respond to it? Well, he heard from God. He definitely heard from God, and you must understand, in Abraham's time, there was no written word. There was just the spoken word. But the spoken word is now the written word because we have record of how that God dealt with Abraham. But what Abraham heard from God, Abraham responded unto. And God told him to offer up his son. God was testing him. And the Bible says he heeds God's word and he takes his son Isaac and they go towards the place that God had told him of. The Bible says he takes two servants with him. He takes two of his servants with him. They load the timber, they load everything, and they go towards the place that God told him. And afar off he sees the place Moriah. And Moriah means to see Jehovah. Moriah means to see Jehovah, and he was to sacrifice his son on Mount Moriah. This is a type of Calvary. On Calvary, we see Jesus Christ crucified. We see God dying for you and I. And he was to offer up Isaac on Mount Moriah. Now, he said that that very place where he offered up Isaac was the very place that they built the two temples. The temple of Solomon and later the temple that Herod built. At the exact spot where Isaac was to be sacrificed, they built the temples. The house of God. But now ask yourself the question. If God had told you, offer up your only son. If you were Abraham, what would cause you to heed God's word and obey God's word? The answer is this. He heard from God to offer up his son. Amen. He heard from God to offer up his son. But he also heard earlier on, previously from God, that God will make the covenant not with Ishmael, but with Isaac. That from his own bowels, God will bring forth a son, and God's blessings would continue in the sons that came from his own body and Sarah's own body. Now, I'm going to say something, and once again, please, don't think I'm being rude. But they interfered with the promise of God, and what she done, Sarah, she offered Hagar, her maid, to Abraham. But she offered Hagar to him, Abraham, not as a so-called one-night stand, but as a wife. So Hagar became his second wife. So in a sense, we can say that legally, that Hagar was married to Abraham. But although she was married legally, in a sense, to Abraham, God did not recognize her son Ishmael, but only Isaac. Because the promise was not with Isaac, or rather with Ishmael, it was with Isaac. Then also, when Ishmael is about 13 years old, God gives Abraham a sign that God's going to keep his promise to Sarah and himself, that they will have a child. And by the way, the child was to be called Isaac, which means laughter, joy, happiness. This son was to bring happiness to Abraham and Sarah, not as the son Ishmael had brought sorrow to Sarah. And God gives him a sign. And this sign that God gives him is the sign of circumcision. And notice, at this time, Isaac is not born as yet. Ishmael is about 13 or 14 years old. And what does Abraham do? He has every male circumcised, even himself. Amen. And God gives him a sign that God will give him seed from his own body and seed from his own wife, his first wife, Sarah. And this is circumcision. We carry rings on our fingers, not so? This is to remind us that we made promises to a certain man or and a certain woman. This is the seal. This is the token of our contract. Are you with me? This reminds me that I'm married to Dolores. That when a beautiful woman comes past and I look twice and I want to look the third time, I must look at my ring. I'm married to her. Amen?
Amen.
And God gave this seal, this sign to Abraham of circumcision. And it really meant there, remember when God appeared to Abraham and he confirmed the covenant the third time? Abraham was 99 years old. His body was powerless as such. And God gives him a sign that shows him he's powerless, that he's beyond the capability of producing after his own kind. In fact, his wife is 90 years old and her womb is dead. And God just shows him by the act of circumcision that he's powerless and that God is the one to bring to pass the promise of thine only son. Amen?
Amen.
Abraham has now to exercise faith because God says, offer up thine only son. Notice what Abraham says to those two men that he brings along. He says, wait here. Me and the boy are going yonder to worship, and we will come back to you. We will come back to you. How could Abraham say that? Abraham could say that although Abraham was concerned that he had to offer up Isaac, Abraham's mind and spirit went back to the earlier words that God said to him. And Abraham was saying to himself, we will come back. And Abraham in his heart knew, even if he had to sacrifice that child, that God would raise him from the dead. You read Hebrews chapter 11, verse 19. He believed God to raise Isaac from the dead. They go up the mountain. Now notice this. Notice. The Bible says as they about to ascend that Abraham lays the wood upon the young lad. He lays the wood upon the young lad. In other words, you're going to be the sacrifice and you carry the means which is going to sacrifice you. a picture of how that Jesus Christ carried his own cross. As they go up, the young man says, Father, we've got all that we require for the sacrifice, the wood, the fire, the knife, everything, but where is the lamb? Where is the lamb? Some of the other, Isaac knew that something was amiss, that something was just not right. And once again, Abraham speaks a word of faith. And listen, he could only speak a word of faith because he heard God previously speak to him. And he said, "Hear, my son, don't worry. God will provide. God will provide." I don't know what happened on that mountain, but I can imagine that Isaac was a strong young man. Strong in the sense he carried all that wood for the sacrifice. So it must have been quite an enormous amount of wood, quite heavy. Not so. So that means he was a strong lad. I can't say what I'm saying. I'm correct in what I'm saying. But I don't think for one moment that Isaac was willing to lay down and be sacrificed. Jesus said, "No man takes my life, I give my life." But Isaac in no way was willing to give his life. That's why I believe that Abraham had to overpower him some way or the other. I don't know how. But I don't think for one moment that the conscious Isaac lay there, tied up, unconscious. But Jesus said, "No man takes my life. I give my life." Abraham takes the knife. He's about to plunge the dagger into the heart of his son. And notice what the Bible says. Constantly, God says to Abraham, "Thine only son, who you love." Your only son, who you love. And God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And Abraham took the knife. And I can imagine his heart's cry. And as he plunged going down, he heard the voice of God. He heard the voice of God. The just shall live by faith. Faith in the word of God. Abraham heard from God and he said, "Me and the boy will come back to you." And he said to the boy, "God will provide a lamb." God stopped him. There was the ram in the thicket. And Abraham released his son Isaac, slaughtered the lamb, and offered it up to God. God made a way. God made a way. God has spoken to you. There has been spoken words in your life. And don't be deterred by what I said. You heard from God. And you've checked it up according to God's word. Then you've heard from God. Hold God to that word he spoke to you. Maybe you heard it just been read from the Bible. Maybe the preacher mentioned it. Maybe it was a prophecy. You never interfered with it. You just put it in your heart and you waited upon God and you warred against the powers of darkness for God to bring that prophecy or that word to pass. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
If what God has spoken to you is based upon this word, it will come to pass. It will come to pass. What has God promised you? You look at your wayward children. You see them going a way that is contrary to the Word of God, involved in a life that is demeaning, bound and shackled by sin. God has spoken, and God said they will be saved. You confirmed that word. You sought it out, and you discovered in Acts 16 it says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved and your household. I know of a woman in terrible pain. I can't tell you where she was at, but in a very embarrassing situation. And she cried out to God, and she got a vision of the Lord, and the Lord said, come unto me, all ye that labor. And God touched her there that day. I know of a woman recently. She got a vision of God. She saw the crown of thorns and the blood just dripping down the face of Jesus. And Jesus said to her, I've done it for you. Perhaps your body is riddled with sickness and disease. There's no hope for you. Perhaps God gave you a word that he would heal you. The word says he is the Lord that heals us. Your spoken word will always be confirmed by the written word. God will heal you. You look at your situation financially. It's so difficult these days. For too long, we're renting. For too long, we have the landlords over us, giving us a difficult time. But who knows? Perhaps God promised you your own house. Believe God. Find it in the Word. God says if your delight is the Lord, then God will not hold any good thing from you. If you seek first the kingdom of God, he will add all what you require. God honors his word. He stands behind his word to perform his word. Perhaps your husband is not serving the Lord. Perhaps your wife is not serving the Lord. But Jesus says that the one sanctifieth the other. They shall be saved. Let's stand together. Let's bow our heads. What are you trusting God for today? What's your need? My Bible says that God will not withhold any good thing from those who walk upright. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all what you require will be added unto you. God will meet your need. My Bible says that my God shall supply all our need according to his riches in Christ Jesus. My Bible says we will lack no good thing. Over the years, God has spoken to you. Maybe you've cried for so long for God to intervene in your family life. There's no more joy, there's no more happiness in your marriage. God is a great restorer. God can bring joy back to that marriage. God can deal with that wayward son. God can deal with that sickness. God can deal with that poverty. All that you need is to have a word from God. Let me assure you, God speaks to us. Amen. Amen. When he speaks a spoken word, we always check it out in the written word. We don't run with the word spoken unless it's confirmed by the written word. And God has promised you health. God has promised you wealth. God has promised salvation to your family. God cannot go back on his word. You've got to be like Abraham. You've got to heed God's word. You've got to obey God's word. Whatever your need is this afternoon, don't worry about the time. Whatever your need is this afternoon, you come. I want to pray for you. Whatever your need is, come. I want to pray for you. Don't be shy. If you need a touch from God, then God is here. If you need finance, God is here. If you need joy in your marriage to be restored, God is here. If you need salvation, God is here. God is not a man that he should lie. He watches over his word he has spoken, and he confirms his word spoken to you by the written word. Hallelujah. What do you need from God this morning? This afternoon, rather. What is your need? My God is more than able. He's the God of the possible and the impossible.